today is planning committee. Before we start proceedings, I've got quite a few announcements to make this morning, so I'll try and get these as soon as possible. First of all, in terms of housekeeping, please first of all ensure your mobile phones are either on silent or off. If you need to take any urgent calls on a quiet day outside the chamber, we'd ask you to leave while you do so you don't disrupt today's proceedings. During the course of the meeting, there will be opportunities for people to speak, but only if you've added your name to the public list, which my colleague to the rear of the chamber have been taking names for. If you do wish to speak and have not entered your name to this list at this stage, please raise your hand now and we'll come and take your name and details, and when the appropriate time comes, you'll be invited forward to the address committee. Please note that for those in favour and those against any application today, in view of the large number of applications the committee has to deal with, we are only permitting 3 minutes to speak per individual. And then more, we will be strict on times on this occasion. We also remind you that any comments must be confined to planning matters only, simply for the reason that those are the only matters which the planning committee can take into consideration when determining any of the applications. At this stage, it is also my sad duty to advise the committee of the death of John McIntosh, who was the former chair of this committee for many years. Before we move to a minute's silence, can I invite comments from members of the committee, but certainly my capacity as clerk to this committee and having worked with John for many years, I found John an incredibly honest, hard-working and genuine man to deal with. It was a pleasure to work with him over the years, and it was certainly deeply missed by myself and my colleagues. Over to my colleagues on the committee.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. It was with real sadness that we learned today that over the weekend, sadly, John had passed away last Thursday. John was a gentle, caring man who was passionate about the city that he loved. Under his stewardship, the city's skyline has been transformed. Being a chair of a committee like planning can be really daunting and often very thankless. Trying to be fair to all sides in often controversial circumstances can be difficult. But despite the provocation and sometimes heated debate, John never lost his cool. He never lost his temper, and he was always there to give help and support to his colleagues. John served a total of 27 years as a councillor. He also served as chair of this committee, to my knowledge, from 2010 until last year. He was a friend and a comrade, and we'll be greatly missed. And I'm sure I speak for all members of this committee and officers in sending our deepest condolences to John's family at this sad time.
Chair, on behalf of the opposition members, not only of this committee but of the council, I would like to support the comments that have just been made by Councillor Conception. Being chair of the planning committee, as you will be aware, is never an easy job. You can't satisfy every councillor, you can't satisfy every demand that is placed on you. The key thing that John had in dealing with this was both patience and a sense of humour. Sometimes that is easily forgotten in a chamber which is often heavily political. Of course, he wasn't just the chair of the planning committee, he represented for a long time one of the most deprived wards of this city and did sterling service for his constituents. He will be sadly missed as an individual who contributed a lot to the city that he so greatly loved.
Any further comments from members? If not, can I ask that we please stand and observe in silence? first of all invite any questions from members of the committee, please. We have no agenda items of business to today, so therefore, can I invite the committee to consider the minutes of our last meeting, those of the 13th of March 2018, pages 1 to 14 of your agenda. Are there any comments from members? Are those agreed? Thank you. Well, Chair, just in view of the number of items we have before committee today, we have had a number of requests to bear in the order of business, but simply view the number of items at this stage, that's not going to be practical at this stage, but we will get through the business as speedily as possible, allowing anyone to speak. Can we also advise everyone as well that those of you who are here for the latter items on the agenda, the committee will be breaking for approximately half an hour's lunch break around about midday, depending on how the items fall. So for those of you who are here for later items, thank you for your patience and understanding in that regard. With that in mind, we move straight away to item number 4, which relates to the plot C of the Wavertree Technology Park, Liverpool 30.
Thank you. Can I invite Andy Garnett and Mike Gregory to come forward to speak on behalf of the application?
Good morning, members of the Planning Committee. My name is Andy Garnett and I'm the Land and Planning Director for MCI Development Limited, who are the owners and the applicant of the site. The scheme before you today is for 48 new residential developments. As some of you may well be aware, there is an existing planning permission in place for 40 dwellings, which was granted as recently as May 2017. Should planning be granted today, funding has been secured to build 100% of the dwellings within 18 months in partnership with the local registered provider, Your Housing Group. This equates to a total investment of £6 million within the area. As part of the application, we have consulted with local board members, the Highways Authority, National Rail and Natural England. We do understand people have concerns with regard to ecology, highways and the loss of trees. However, as demonstrated in the committee report before you and as part of the previously approved scheme, this development equates to a marginal increase in traffic flows with minimal impact on the highways network. As further demonstrated by the committee report, concerns regarding ecology have also been addressed throughout the determination period of the application. An appropriate mitigation scheme for protected species has been agreed with NIAS and Natural England. I brought along with me today my colleague and agricultural expert, Mr. Mike Gregory of Trevor Bridge Associates. He will provide you details of how our scheme will incorporate a new landscaping buffer and replace any of the existing trees lost for this new development. To conclude, this application has been recommended for approval by officers. It is broadly in line with the previously approved scheme. It is technically sound and it will facilitate significant investment into the area, providing much needed housing for local residents. I would urge members to approve this application. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Mike Gregory, I'm the project horticulturalist. There are no individual trees of significant merit within the site, however, commonwealth of trees and vegetation can be deemed to have collective merit. They combine wildlife corridors and create screening and provide a level of visual amenity. The most significant corridor with green infrastructure within the site is along the westerly boundary, visiting to the north of the site, small wooded area to the south, which itself leads to some trees, partly to the rear of Tiverton Street. The development, if approved, would in place as a result of.
Could you just move a little bit away from the microphone?
Okay, sorry. I'll start that paragraph again. Is that better? Okay. The development, if approved, will in places result in reducing the width of sections of these corridors, but crucially will ensure that a continuous corridor can be maintained on the western boundary adjacent to the railway. In addition, new vegetation will be planted within these retained belts, both initially and long term, following ongoing management. The woodland at the southern tip of the site, which will remain undisturbed for the proposed development, will be managed to create woodland crops, including native understory plants. What is crucial is not the number of trees or plants being proposed as a replacement, but the quality of planting and long-term management. It will involve a long-term approach that will require monitoring intervention and applying a management plan with clear objectives to replace, mitigate and enhance as necessary. And then the existing trees are still relatively mature, with sections containing species of trees that are relatively short-lived and likely to require management intervention to mature, regardless of any development proposals. In the case of poplars, which are abundant in some places, this would usually comprise pollarding or complete removal. New planting will occur at the center of site, as detailed in the landscape plan that supports the application. The scheme also proposes to provide a committed sum of £38,400 for the provision and maintenance of new shoot trees to the local community, which will provide an agricultural gain within the local urban environment. If you have any questions, I'll thank you, Councillor.
Are there any questions? Councillor Kemp.
Yes, I'm a little unclear on the chronology of this, that work was done, was it without the formal environmental application being approved by the planning department?
I understand works have been undertaken on this site, but I was not directly involved in any decision from the town
office. So that's the office.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? Thank you very much. Now I'm going to invite forward Councillor Lawrence Brown, followed by Councillor Dave Cummings. I don't know if Councillor Michael Dyer is also willing to speak or wants to speak. Yes, okay.
Thank you, Chair. About 2 months ago, I received a telephone call from a resident who was concerned that works were beginning on this site and that actual trees were being removed. That's quite invasive, actually, around about early February. The position is, I think, in agreement with what Councillor Kemp has just said, with this was without the agreement of planning, although it's not clear whether they had to have agreement of planning to be doing that, because they are the landowner and the trees are protected. Having said that, it's my view that this constitutes overdevelopment, this particular application. The outline application was agreed for 40 dwellings, this is now 48 dwellings. Although the site is designated as industrial commercial land, it does have a large number of trees on it, but it also has, as you've just seen from the photograph displayed, quite a substantial pond area as well, which is part home to a protected species, the great crested newt. There's also a likelihood of bats in the area. The trees that were removed were growing at a substantial rate, as I pointed out, and I have concerns that the replacements of those trees will not be substantial. It might well be a well-managed scheme, perhaps, at the end of the day, but the existence of 48 dwellings right up on the doorstep of a protected species, which goes virtually right onto the pond area you've just seen, will threaten the species in that area, in my view, and the view of ecologists that I've spoken to as well. What we've got here is we've got substantial human habitable development on an interesting and sort of protected or undisturbed part of the land. Residents are already beginning to feel the effects of the removal of the trees through light and noise pollution from the nearby railway works, and I suspect that will continue to worsen in the future. They're also concerned about highway matters as well, but I'll leave that to other people to determine as to how important they are. So for substantial loss of trees, for the fact that it's overdevelopment from the original agreed outline application, I believe that this should be refused and rejected. Thank you.
Are there any questions, Councillor Cummings? Oh, Councillor
Sutton,
carry on.
Yes, Chair, I was just going to ask, is the Councillor Brown aware that there are revised landscaping plans, which includes 78 new trees, mixed native hedging comprising 974 plants, hedges comprising 1,670 plants, 8 of shrub planting with 952 plants, 594 ornamental shrubs and 14 special shrubs, planting with climbers, grass mix and wildflowers, and there's also street planting, which is part of the planning game proposal. Are you aware of that?
Yeah, I am aware of that, thank you.
I thought that you were going to make a comment.
I am aware of that, thank you, Councillor Conception here. My view is that's after the horse has bolted. We are threatening the protected species here, not just one, I think there might be bats as well. And those issues of replanting, I think, won't attract, if any other previous developments or anything to go by, won't attract the same sort of habitat and wildlife that the current situation exists. Thank you.
So, Councillor Cummins, if you'd like to come forward, I don't know if Councillor McIntyre wants to come up, do it, so I've done. It's up to you.
Thank you, Chair. Obviously, I'm Dave Cummings, and I'm one of the elected councillors for the area. I've been asked to speak on many residents we have. Roughly 30 to 35 people. I just wanted to pick up the question that Councillor Conception raised. With regard to the plant of the trees, that's going to take approximately 25 to 30 years to bring it back to the situation where, about the trees that have been taken down, which I don't think that's acceptable. Overall, I don't have an issue with the building of new houses. What my issue is about the access of the plot itself. At the moment, they want a two-way access to a one-way street. The two streets are Tiverton and Taunton Street. To have one access into that plot, into a one-way street, is not good. Furthermore, those two streets will be under a lot more use from the traffic of the new plot. Liverpool City Council will have to deal with the issues of the uses of the overuse of those two roads, which does need to be taken into contention. The reason why I think this proposal should be rejected is this: I have no problem with houses to be built in the area. What my problem is the lack of access to that plot. Now, the other end of the plot, there will be access into the technology park, and that will be a walk cycleway. If there was a roadway into the technology park, that means that the access to the existing roads will be manageable, and the traffic can go out to Picton Road, Edge Lane, and all the other areas. If this planning was changed to make sure that another road could go out of that plot rather than a small access into two old roads that have a one-way system which interferes with the one-way system, but furthermore puts more stress on those two roads, Thornton and Tipton Road. That is my issue. Another thing as well about that is there are elderly and vulnerable people that live there, and I've seen children constantly play on those roads. Now, if you're going to get 40, 50 odd cars, and let's not forget, people don't just have one car, they have two or three cars. So that could be three, fourfold. That is an issue for the children and vulnerable people across those roads, and people with disabilities and visual disabilities. You have to take that into contention. That's why I think there should be another access into the technology park. If that was so, I would vehemently support a new planning application, if that was so. Furthermore, you have to recognise that on Hay Green Road that comes off Taunton, there's a children's school there of infants, right? And that children's school is full of capacity, so all children are there. And can you imagine the traffic issues that are going to go on there, and the health and safety issues of the traffic? Right, so on those issues, I reject this proposal.
Hi, Councillor McIntyre, also Wavertree Ward Councillor. I just want to support my colleague Dave Cummins and also Councillor Brown. We've had two residents' meetings And thank you to MCS for attending one of those and listening to our residents. Basically, I just want to reiterate what other people have said. We just need to look a little bit more carefully at things like pollution. Since the trees have gone down, I have noticed there is a lot of light pollution in the houses that back onto Wavertree Technology Park. Residents are concerned about traffic and they are concerned about the ecology. And so I also am raising objections to this development as it stands at the moment. Thank you.
Can you just wait a minute? I don't know if Councillor Cummins wants to come back for any questions. Councillor Kemp's certainly got one. Councillor Kemp.
Yes, I just want to understand the position of the Board of Councillors. You're suggesting that this would be acceptable to you if the vehicular access was from the Enterprise Park, which of course was originally designed to be, and there could be something like a gate so that people, somewhere on Eddington Street, somewhere like that, so that people could walk into it but not drive into it. Have I understood that correctly?
Yes, yes.
Can I come back on that? What I'm saying is this: the one exit that they have planned now, I do not accept that. If they have another exit supporting the one that meets the one-way system, so therefore could have that road could meet the one-way system and the other exit that I propose as well into the technology park as a one-way system out. That is much more acceptable across every issue that I've raised.
Are there any other questions? Thank you, councillors. So can we hear from our planning officer and possibly our high resident as well to address the issues that have been raised? And
thank you, Chair. We obviously have a very thorough and detailed report. I'm wondering if there's a plan that we've got available of the overall layout. Oh dear, apologies. Can I perhaps share this one? It's not a complete plan so far, it doesn't include all the landscaping, but it does actually show the layout. I'll pass that around. Apologies for that, Chair. It was requested. What you have here is a site which was originally allocated as part of the Wavertree Technology Park. As you've heard, the Planning Commission has recently been granted in outline, i.e. just for the principle, for residential development. Some of the issues have come about as a consequence of the works that took place on the site, as you've heard from Councillor Brown, back in the early part of February, where a number of trees were felled and cleared, quite a significant number, particularly along that western boundary, but elsewhere through the site as well. And that triggered quite a lot of objections and concerns from local residents. As a consequence of that, the applicants have liaised with the residents, they have liaised more closely with us as officers, and they have tried to resolve some of the concerns that have been articulated to you this morning, particularly around the loss of trees and about the ecological impact. And those issues are dealt with fully in the report. In terms of the trees, Council Conception has pointed out there is a significant amount of further planting. It is not all tree planting, but in your officer's view and in the view of the applicant's own experts, the understory and shrub planting will provide an equally effective buffer, particularly on that western boundary. A lot of the planting is things like hazel and blackthorn, and so those are shrubs and planting which will actually have some height to them and will provide a much denser coverage than individual trees. So on that point, your officers consider that the proposals are now acceptable. In terms of ecology, we have consulted very closely with our experts at the Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service. They have looked at the revised landscaping and the revisions that were made as a consequence of the works that were undertaken on site back in February. Again, it was something that residents were very concerned about, and again, the applicants have picked that up and impacts have advised that there is no undue impacts of the various conditions they've outlined. The other issues, Chair, in terms of impact on amenity and so on, are as in the report. I would, however, like to draw your attention to the additional note, which talks about the particular interface distance. The distances are slightly different to that that's in your note, so it's closer to 14 metres and 11.5 metres between properties. But again, as it says in the update note, we're quite happy with that relationship. And then finally, Chair, in terms of highway matters, I do understand the concerns that have been raised by the two ward councillors, and I will leave it to my colleagues from Highways to perhaps address that more fully. However, in planning terms, your office's view is that this is now a residential site. It no longer forms part of the technology park. It forms an extension to the residential area. Part of the reason it's not been successful, my understanding is that as a business site is because of its layout and its position in the site and the Wavertree Technology Park site. And so it fits more closely with the surrounding residential area. And so in planning terms, rather than highway terms, I think it makes sense to have it accessed from the residential neighbourhood and keep that separate with the existing Wavertree Technology Park. There are also highway technical reasons, and I'll pass over now to my colleague to pick up on some of those things in more detail.
Thanks, Chair. I'm Ethan Wolf from Planning and Development Control. Yeah, just picking up on the comments there made by the planning officer, we need to agree that it's entirely appropriate to access what is a residential development from a residential area and a network of residential roads. Just to put things in context in relation to the level of traffic that will be generated or is expected to be generated by development of this size, bearing in mind it's been previously consented for 40 dwellings and now this application is for 48. In the AM peak period, the AM peak hour will be at 20 vehicles per hour spread over that hour, and in the PM, 23 vehicles. That equates to one vehicle approximately every 3 minutes, which when you consider the impact of that, we believe that would be negligible on the surrounding highway network. There are a couple of one-way streets that alternate in terms of providing access through to Pecuniary Road, and they can remain in place. The access road at the top, which is Eddington Street, that's two-way at the moment, and that will remain two-way. We just need to adjust some of the signage at the junction where the access is provided. As far as we're concerned, the level of traffic that will be generated by this development can easily be accommodated on the surrounding highway network, and we don't have any concerns in that regard.
Are there any questions for planning on highways? The questions can only be from the committee members. Councillor.
Just on the traffic, the building and that, what during construction is it possible that you can open it, but rather than the construction vehicles going down and they go, kind of come in from the industrial site, just for construction phase?
Yeah, certainly that's something that we would be keen to explore with the developer to try and minimise the impact of any construction traffic going through the residential area. There is actually a planning condition suggested to be added to any approval notice, which requires the developer to submit a construction traffic management plan to us for our approval. We'll be keen to see construction access taken by Stevenson's right away enterprise way if that's possible.
Councillor Ken.
Two questions. First to the planning officer. I take it as far as ensuring that this land be retained for commercial and industrial uses was the original intention. That's also voted to stay because of the Outback Planning Commission. Then a question to the traffic officer. What I think you haven't explained in this matter is what happens when traffic leaving this site actually wants to leave it onto Rathbone Road. Because the access from the, I don't know whether it's Timberwood or one of the system goes on to Rathbone Road, very near a heavily constrained traffic lights, a four-way set of traffic lights, which are anything like these types and often outside long queues of traffic trying to get through those lights. I wonder if you could tell us what recommendations you have for ensuring that that situation is dealt with by measures on that firm road itself.
Thank you, Chair. We're well aware of the junction of Picton Road and Rathbone Road and Picton Road. That is a very busy junction. It does suffer during peak periods from traffic queues. In terms of mitigation or improvements to that junction, it's a very constraining location where there's buildings on all four corners. So to try and introduce a scheme which would significantly increase the capacity of that junction would be very, very challenging. Having said that, in terms of this particular development, there are multiple routes to access and egress from the site. There's the two one-way streets which link down to Picton Road, but also there's a route through via Eddington Street which then leads to onto Rathbone Road. So residents who are accessing or egressing the site have a choice of routes to take, and therefore no doubt would seek to try and avoid any congestion that occurs at that nearby junction.
Could I ask the planning officer to comment on the concerns raised by Councillor Brown in relation to the Greater Crescent Mute? I understand reading the report that there are certain conditions attached to the application that would protect these species.
Absolutely right, Councillor Conception. Obviously, by coming off, the applicants have been aware of the pond, which is just slightly off that plan. It's not part of the application site, and there is a view that that is a habitat that is capable of supporting Great Crescent Mute. I'm not entirely convinced that the ecological report of Great Crescent Mute have actually been found there. I think it's more that it's a habitat where this kind of the Great Crescent Mute would be supported. I stand to be corrected on that. Nonetheless, the applicants have acknowledged the potential for Great Crescent Mute here and have retained quite a significant area of land to the northern part of the site, which includes the cycle passing connections through to the Wavertree Technology Park, but also to provide basically a corridor for the Great Crescent Mute. When the additional work took place, or sorry, the work took place to the trees back in the early start of February, we were concerned that that had not been picked up by the various reports that have been submitted to the application. So we asked the applicants to revisit that ecological report and work closely with our experts at the Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service to ensure that the planting and the revisions that were being undertaken as a consequence of these were picked up and dealt with through these further reports. They've been looked at by the Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service, who are happy with the conclusions and the various requirements that have been put forward. And they are now all set out in conditions in the planning commission.
Thank you very much. Are there any further questions? So I'll go on. I'd also like to add a comment myself, having been an ex-biologist, that don't forget that canopy, the trees, might take a very long time to establish themselves, but these over 4,000 other plants will be up and running a lot sooner and hopefully provide a lot of cover if there are any bats or great crested newts in the area. So can I move that the recommendation as amended be approved? Is that agreed? Thank you. And can we now move on to item 5, which is land at Prince's Jetty, Prince's Dock, Liverpool Waters, a hybrid application at outline for permission requested. So can I invite Mike Hughes and Peter Skates to come forward with the applicant?
The application seeks full planning permission for the demolition of the existing
redundant and derelict structures at Prince's Jetty and outlining planning permission for the construction of a new cruise line terminal facility and supporting information. The site includes the disused Prince's Jetty, Prince's Parade, service car parks, the floating pontoons which contain a lower cruise terminal building. These pontoons will be retained as they act as a permanent landing stage for the cruise ships. The new cruise terminal will be built at Prince's Jetty. The panel officer reports an excellent summary of the key issues. I don't want to repeat these this morning, but I want to just emphasise a number of key points. Firstly, the proposal has been very carefully integrated into the Prince's Dock area, as you can see from the slides. The proposed terminal building will be built on a new suspended deck on the site of the disused Prince's Jetty. Coach parking and drop-off will be located at the front of the building on the former car park on the opposite side of Prince's Parade. Prince's Parade will be retained as a two-way road. We have, in consultation with the officers, dealt with all the technical issues, including transport, noise and air quality. Whilst the proposals are outlined at this stage, we presented a preferred design option, which is shown on the screen, with a sloping roof. The proposal will create a state-of-the-art cruise terminal facility with a strong, simple roof which twists across the site. The proposed building has been designed to complement the historic waterfront environment and enhance the port as an international cruise liner destination. The interior, as you can see, shows the passenger lounge at the first floor, at the first floor cafe, which provides views out towards the cruise liner berthing area, the river and the arrivals atrium. The design will incorporate facilities for disabled visitors. These will include disabled changing facilities, a changing places toilet facility, additional disabled lifts, including fire evacuation lifts. In order to provide you with a brief glimpse of the detailed designs which are currently being worked on, we've included two images of the building. The appearance of the building, although this is not part of the outline application, we thought it would be useful to show you how the scheme is developing. In conclusion, the proposed cruise terminal building will provide significant benefits to the city, including significantly increasing the terminal capacity to cater for the expected growth in passenger numbers. It will enhance the promotion of Liverpool as a visitor destination, regionally, nationally and internationally, and help to showcase the unique cultural heritage of the city and its waterfront. A successful cruise liner facility will generate economic benefits for the city, in particular increasing visitor spend, which will have a positive effect on the local economy. I hope this presentation provides you with an insight into these exciting proposals and the importance of these proposals for the city and the region. I'd ask the members to support the officer's recommendation to approve the application. Just here to answer your questions, if it does.
Are there any questions? Councillor Kemp.
The first is simply a technical one. One of the benefits of the existing location is the ease in which people can walk straight to the Unar building and onwards. Will there be pedestrian access through to the roads and then
obviously? Absolutely, that's lovely incorporated into the public realm as part of this, yes.
Yeah, fine. And the second thing is, you rightly say, fortunately, that this is only an outline application, which I have no problem with. I must say that if this was a full application, I would be asking you lots of questions about the unsympathetic design of the building you're creating. So could I just forewarn you?
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Okay, then. Thank you. And can I invite up my name, so to speak now, please?
Thanks, Chair. I'm Peter Jones, the team lead for the City Centre team, and also the case officer with Waters applications. So you've heard today this is a hybrid application, and just to remind you, it's part outline part four. The full permission is required to establish the principle that it's a suitable location for a cruise liner terminal, and also for the demolition works of the existing terminal jetty. The outline part sets the parameters for the reserve matters application, which will come forward. The Matter Council Games comments will come to pretty begin to see that those proposals when they are worked up. But that will be subject to a separate application. The report's twice the full report, and it takes you through all the different issues very, very carefully. Just explains how the principle of development conforms with the planning policy, and also quite importantly, the relationship with everything else that's happening in the Liverpool water scheme. Dealers have gifted the site to the city and are very supportive of the application, which bets in well with the developments which are planned in Princeton and across the through to Central Docks. The report explains the impact on the World Heritage Site. It's not in the World Heritage Site, it's in the buffer zone, and it's also in close proximity to a number of heritage assets. You'll see from the report that part of the rock wall by our town tower is actually very significant. Just to examine the details to understand how that relationship and that would be again subject to a separate application. But importantly, the conclusions of the heritage impact assessment confirm that whilst it will cause a slight harm to the outstanding universal value of the World Heritage Site, that harm, given the extent of the World Heritage Site, is relatively small and is certainly outweighed by the benefits of the development to the people of that site. Historic England are very supportive of the application, and they think it's a perfectly appropriate location given the tradition of the city as a place for people to come and embark, and that's the perfect location for it. Environmental considerations have been a really important part of the assessments of the application. We've had several meetings with Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service for Natural England, and that's led to some strengthening of the planning conditions, which are referred to in the table, to make sure that it complies with the habitats regulations. You'll see from the report that in addition to planning permission, this will also require a marine licence and a harbour revision order, and that's because some of the works are also in the river, and they'll be subject to separate processes. In terms of traffic, the application is supported by a transport assessment, which looks in detail at the proposals, and you'll see from the report it mentions the fact that as part of the city centre highway improvement scheme, there are proposals to create a new dual carriageway extension to Mead Street, which will ultimately serve this site. That is subject to a separate application, which is coming forward later on this year. In any event, theoretically, this site could be accommodated within the existing highway network, and that's demonstrated by the transport assessment. But ultimately, we will get a new road as part of those more extensive there are a range of controls to ensure that in terms of construction, how it affects the people who live closest by it, and how are protected, their interests are protected, so typical things are noise controls, how it's working, and so on. But subject to all those conditions and the data conditions in the update note, Chair, we'll be happy to recommend approval.
Are there any questions? So, can I?
Not a question.
Possibly, Councillor Conception, carry on.